Music, you know, it's the lifeblood. It's like lifeblood of the people. Like oil is to Saudi Arabia.
No one in their wildest dreams would ever have thought that a small island like Jamaica has now been able to create a music that is part of the mainstream.
We need it, we must have it.
You get up, stand up.
Oh, you bring the woman access to your villa. Just for son of witness, all of your clean all your pillar. You better watch your back before she turn into a killer. Just
review the situation. The music is something like a gravity, like a magnet. It insists to hold on to you.
I've been touched by an angel.
Forward! March!
On August 5th, 1962, Princess Margaret finally pulled down the Union Jack after more than 300 years of British rule in Jamaica. The soundtrack to this newfound freedom was the first truly Jamaican music, the newly invented ska.
The Lord is still with you.
Because the time has come and we can have some fun, so take a run. You know, it was just a simple song, and the people them jumped to it, and you know, going around. Whoa, we're independent, and you know, flash them hands, and it was great. That was something to see, and never can come back in Jamaica.
We're independent, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Independence came at a time when ska wasn't in speak.
Yes.
And so it was just jubilation all around.
You understand?
You know, with the acceptance that we were now a free country and ska in its peak. And everyone just went crazy for it.
You couldn't go to a party before 62 to play ska. After that night, you had to play ska for the party to be successful. It was unbelievable. Everyone gravitated to it. They saw something new, and I noticed something too. They had pride. When they looked at it, they said, this is ours.
It would have been nice to say, well, independence caused people to want their own music, but the music preceded independence. But it was a wonderful coincidence, because independence gave it further drive. The music came first.
The story of modern Jamaican music starts in the early 1950s in the poorer areas of downtown Kingston, with the emergence of a uniquely Jamaican phenomenon. Still at the heart of the music 50 years later, the sound system. The sound system is essentially a street discotheque with speakers big enough to raise a family in. It's where poor Jamaicans have been coming to dance till they drop, ever since they stopped listening to jazz bands in the now ruined clubs all over the island.
You had sound system before recording. You have the first, it started, the Jamaican music started off with orchestra dance. But when the sound system came in, they replaced the musician, because people used to hire these bands to play, but the musician used to stop and eat a lot of curry goat, so it burn up a lot of time, and you know.
The band would go in intermission, and intermission forever. So the people got to get fed up of this no dance, but they never dance. So in the intermission, they made a mistake. They agreed that the first sound system should play in the intermission. That was the end of them. I never turned back. It was all about rhythm and blues.
As the 1950s rolled on, the music of Fats Domino, Ray Charles, and Louis Jordan was streaming into the island from Southern American radio stations just over 90 miles away. And with the sound systems blasting it out most nights of the week, downtown Kingston went dance crazy. And like any craze, it was rich with opportunity.
People used to make money from it. You sell your own beer, and you sell your own curry goat and rice, and you got the sounding system from 8 o'clock till like 6 in the morning, and they eating and dancing in the street. You get like 2,000-3,000 people, and you make a bump.
Sound systems became the biggest local industry in downtown Kingston, and competition was fierce. To pull in the punters, you had to have the best music blasting out of your system. The race was on for the hottest American tunes.
It's a Rico sensation.
You know, American people, they need cheap labor, so they bring to cut them cane and things. But while you're there cutting cane, if you buy rhythm and blues, 6 times more money you get, because you're going to sell it back to sound system people. So everybody anxious to go to the farmer, but not for cut cane. They want to go buy some record, you know?
Out of this fierce competition, two giants emerged, Clement Coxon Dodd and Arthur Duke Reed. Combining their liquor businesses with their sound system dances, they were effectively the barons of downtown Kingston and would continue to control the Jamaican music business for the next 15 years.
They could run the country those days because people, where anywhere the sound string up, you have the crowd of people there before. They used to play in competition. It come in now like Joe Fraser and Holly.
Duke Reed is the man who go around this dance and him go to the gate and him get everybody out of the gate money for coming on and dance, you know? And the people, they believe all the cocks and dance and come on to Duke Reed. Sometimes them just take the money and go to the cocks and dance just the same, you know what I mean? So it's like that, so all of them used to be at war, you know? The sound system thing was... It's a traditional thing. You can't stop it. It come from way back, you know? Come on.
Yes, suddenly rum is served to sophisticates because suddenly Jamaican rum has regained its place among the great drinks of the world.
Duke Reed had a rum there where it don't sell in the stores. If you think rum strong, you ask about rude to your parents. When you throw water, you know what happened? Yes. Throw chasing it. What do you think happened? Smoke. The smoke, vapors thing, right? And that is what the brother might drink, like they have cocaine now, that was for them cocaine. So after Duke Reed, give them 2 drinks a root to your parents and send them go cocks and dance. The dance done. People are jump fence to get out the fast.
Duke Reed, he had a program on the radio, I think 4:30 on a Saturday afternoon called Treasure Isle Time. They would advertise the liquor business, and then he would, on those programs, they would play newly made Jamaican records.
They decided to drink some more, but when I look at the clock, it was 3:45.
To promote their sound systems, Reed and his competitors had turned to record producing by the end of the 50s, but not as we know it today. They had no intention of selling records to anyone else. They brought jazz musicians down from the tourist hotels to play Jamaican versions of American R&B. And then they just made one copy of each record to play on their sound system and achieve the much prized exclusive.
We start imitating the rhythm and blues songs like say, Smiley Lewis or Professor Longear or Louis Jordan, you know, those kind of beats. We tried to imitate it. It didn't turn out that way. So we decided to keep this as our own type. That's how that can come in.
Styling like those was really rhythm and blues. What we did to this rhythm and blues is like you'd be doing one, two, three, four, one, two, three, four. But the scano, we change it to one, two, three. And then it's more two, four, two, four, instead of one.
It is Jamaica's first musical revolution. And we call it ska. And then ska was a dirty word. But what it was terribly influenced by Jamaican activities of the people, you know. Culture of Jamaica was pushed into it. And when the people took it on that fast, right, they just grabbed to it because it was them.
This is the way of life of the lower class people. We haven't got anything else. What else do we have? I mean, the middle class or the upper class can buy a ticket and go to Miami or somewhere like that. That's all you have. You don't know anything else.
You would not find the creative force that comes out of the inner city in the residential areas in Jamaica, because they are more settled into a pattern, into a tradition. There's a social divide and a cultural divide. We live in two countries. When ska was popular downtown, it had no popularity uptown.
In 1960, much of uptown Jamaica still preferred American music, and many of the jazz musicians who had invented ska were making a living playing the tourist resorts of the North Coast.
I used to have a serious type of class prejudice in those days, let's call it that way. You know, and it would have hurt my career in a certain sense. You couldn't go uptown and play ska music, so it was really like an outlaw type of music, you know.
In 1960, Prince Buster started his own sound system. To steal a march on his rivals, he approached the ultimate outcasts of Jamaican society, the Rastafarians, who since the 30s had looked to Africa rather than Europe as a model. He persuaded Count Ozzy and his master drummers down from the Warwicka Hills into a recording studio.
At in those days, if you say he's a Rasta, all the avenues black for you now. And when I make Carolina, that give the Rasta, whole Rasta speak. Because now, them, it was not the music world, them could play upon sound system. And if you're playing upon sound system around the island, everybody go and hear you.
In the early years in Jamaica, the Rastafarian community went under so much pressure, you know. At one stage, I think there was a decree in Jamaica.
To
kill the Rasta man and question him after, you know.
Count Ozzy, you know.
You know, 90% of all the grassroots music was really played or created by the Rasta people, you know.
Rasta and Jamaican music have been inseparable ever since. Even at the independence celebrations, Count Ozzy and his troupe were part of the pageant laid on for Princess Margaret, whose reaction remains unrecorded.
We brought with us most of the music of Africa, the rhythm, the kumina as a form of dancing, the nyabingi drumming by our Rastafarians. To that has been fused some of the jazz influences emanating from our sisters and brothers in New Orleans. Culture has been a very strong element in all our art forms, but particularly in our forms of musical expression.
A Lord of Lords in this land,
more by the talk than any of you. Cause I'm king from the beginning. I was made king. Lion says I am king and I reign.
What it developed from was Calypso.
Lion says I am king and I reign.
Well, Calypso singers sing about, they sang about, well, lots of them used to sing about sex. But they also sing about topical things like that. So it's coming out of that. You want to know what's going on? I mean, you know, you listen to the songs. It is a kind of folk music.
Our country contested at the Lyceum the title Miss World. They numbered 40. I'm crowning
you myself. The emerging nation was full of optimism, and with prosperity increasing, everybody wanted to own the ska records that up until now they only had heard on the sound systems.
People started buying Jamaican records. Jamaican records was accepted as the record to buy, because you're hearing yourself, you're hearing things to do with you.
Eager to capitalize on this new market, the sound system operators reinvented themselves as record companies. Prince Buster's Voice of the People, Duke Reed's Treasure Isle, and initially the top label Coxon, run by the taciturn Clement Dodd. He was the first to realize that you could make a living beyond the sound system. With his profits, he set up the legendary Studio One, the first recording studio in Jamaica to be owned by a black man.
Studio One was a permanent place that people recorded almost every day. We were always free to go there and record whenever we feel like. And these are the kind of facilities that you got that made it a special place, you know? Because it's just like home, musically.
Is that the first time that I've been to your home? What is the first time?
Studio One is like Jamaica's Motown. That's where all the great artists, you know, we say they graduate at this place, Studio One. This was like a 9-to-5 job. We went there early morning and we would record all day.
And I went in there at 7. I used to live at Mr. Dad's house with his children.
Yeah.
So every morning, I'd go to the studio with him and open the studio. He would pick up an assistant. His name is Bim Bim.
Yeah, Bim
Pick
Bim,
up Bim Bim first. We go to the studio, we open the studio, and make his rounds. Every day we close the studio every night, drop Bim Bim home. It's like heaven.
Just like in the old days of the sound system, Coxon constantly needed new sounds to stay ahead. Every Sunday morning, young hopefuls gathered in his yard, hawking their songs and looking for a shot at the big time.
The longest liver will see the moon.
Listen to all them guys go up and sing. You know, and every time, but, you know, we would sing around the side, you know, and them would say, you're so good in here, you know. And every time them say, you're a turn, man. I say, no, make them go on, make them go on.
When I saw Coxon himself did an audition, right? Or some auditions too, before I started that. And he would tell artists that he figured weren't ready or didn't want them back. He said, okay, come back 7 years' time, you know?
It was 6 o'clock in the evening. I was the last person to go up. You know, the place was still packed. And, you know, my first song, you got to be sure of a woman's love. Everybody crowd around, man. Everybody say, you're the vice, yeah. You're the vice. Everyone crowd around, you know, and Mr. Dad say, nice. And on a Tuesday, I'm going to do my first two songs.
Another group of youngsters signed by Coxon were the Wailers, Bunny Wailer, Bob Marley, and Peter Tosh. In 1964, within a year of Studio One's opening, they sold an astonishing 70,000 copies of Simmer Down.
Trenchtown was vibrant with a lot of activities. Place was like a, what do you call it, like a Piccadilly. like Hollywood, music as being the center of attraction.
Everybody was singing like a family. So if the Soulettes have a recording, you'd have Bob, Peter Bunny, Delroy, you know, guys from the Paragons, everybody would come to give background support. If the Wailers have a session sometime, you would have the Ask Us Girls come work with us tonight. We have two children listening, looking at all the harmony. So that was like fun. We weren't being paid because Coxon, we didn't get money that time. Sometimes we get money to buy us a patty or cocoa bread, and if we're going on Fridays, we would get a pound or 30 shilling or something like that. But we didn't have a problem.
It was a very productive period in Jamaica's musical history. Hit after hit, you know, every month there would be a new hit for different singers. And it was as if all the singers and the talent in popular music had been kept locked up in a cupboard. But from the first hit was made, it is as if the cupboard doors opened and all this talent just poured out.
Studio One's music was made downtown for downtown people. The musicianship necessary wasn't that easy to achieve if you were poor in Kingston. But luckily, there was also a downtown academy. If Studio One was Motown, the Alpha Boys School was the Juilliard School of Music.
Boys' School is a school that caters to the unfortunate. It teaches them trades that they can earn a living after they leave here, and some go abroad. I think you met Rico Rodriguez. He's a trombonist.
My mother couldn't angle me no more, and that's the way I end up in Alpha. Maybe she feel I'm more protected up there. The young man, him grow very quick, him, you know what I mean? Him become very wise very quickly, you understand? Yeah. Life, tough life, you know, life hard. Okay. And out of poverty, bring it wisdom, you understand?
Why I'm here was because my parents abandoned me, but I thank God for that in some reason. As I said, I must honor thy mother and father, but I still love her, and in the future I'd like to find her. So at Alpha is good. I learn music and I also learn education.
Many of Jamaica's greatest musicians have been from Alpha. Coxon in particular was quick to appreciate the value of the kind of discipline and ability you might expect from that institution. The backbone of his house band were largely Alpha old boys, and they became the first superstars of ska, the Scatterlights.
Oh yes, the Scatterlights. That was Johnny Moore. He is touring France now. And Lester Sterling, he's in America. Tommy McCook was very good at that. He was a saxophonist. You had Don Drummond. He was very quiet. He loved his instrument. And when he was still in school, he was about the best trombonist in Jamaica.
Carolites were a great set of people. At the time, they were the masters. They were learned musicians. They were not just people who played music by, you know, by the breath. They were doing it by the paper. And we, the Wailers, were really enthused to have been working with the Scatterlites.
There came on the scene this talented aggregation, the most formidable array of talent which Jamaica has ever seen in a single band, and dare I say, is ever likely to see in the future.
They were it. Anywhere they played, for dances, the place would be ram jam.
We play at a place one night and see the place loaded with people and a woman come and dance to the scat. And I'm watching that woman dance and I see she kick back. And when we finish playing, go out, I hear the woman die, the decker out. Scans it till she dropped them and dead. Serious thing, man.
That's a ska killer.
Yeah, man. Yeah, man. Ska the light carry a heartbeat. Yeah, man.
The 2 years after independence, with the Scatterlites at their peak, was the golden age of Jamaican ska. But the foundations of the band were shaky. They became frustrated with the insularity of the Jamaican music scene. And more significantly, Don Drummond, the band's greatest genius, was slowly losing his mind. Drummond's virtuoso trombone playing lay at the heart of the Scatterlites' greatest moments.
A lot of his compositions were minor chord tunes. Smooth, more melodic kind of flow, while Rico would be more brassy and more like orchestrated, like, you know, to the beat. Don slides with it.
Drummond took ska to new heights of virtuosity. He had a unique style with a disturbing emotional undertow that reeked of Africa and mirrored the demons in his head.
He got in friendship with this lady, and he didn't like her dancing, and so that brought a sort of a bone of contention between them.
Jealousy and the lack of material and career advancement built up disastrously in the mind of the introspective Drummond. And on New Year's Eve 1964, he killed his girlfriend Margarita.
I used to say to myself, I wonder if he's really guilty of doing that act. But they found him guilty, and then they placed him in the madhouse, Bellevue that is. And after a while, he had some altercation with somebody there, or with people there, and or some fuss, and he died. I was sorry to hear, because he was such a great musician, very, very great, regardless of how mad he was.
Without Don Drummond, the Scatterlites were never quite the same again. And anyway, musicians couldn't make that much money in Jamaica. To make a living, many of the most talented musicians joined the thousands of other Jamaicans on the boat to England.
You know, so I had a change from Jamaica for me. I play music long time, and when I really play with no band or nothing, you know. So coming to England, try out my luck.
Amen.
To the newly arrived Jamaican, London nightlife was a strange and often unnerving experience.
When you go there, you know what they was playing. Bottoms up and the choo-choo-choo and all these kind of things. Knees up. Are you coming from Jamaica where you used to? So we couldn't take it. And the jazz club, well, it's never on. Every club you go in London is, sorry, you got to be a member. Won't let you in. Once you're black, you can't get in. You know what I mean? You couldn't get into Ronnie Scott. You couldn't get into Lion's Corner House, the big jazz club. So then I said to Vinnie, look, you build a song, we will support you and get the record like Jamaica from America. And this is how it starts.
My parents were only here 5 or 6, 7 years, until 1965. So it was almost like a letter from home, hearing rhythms, rhythm tracks from Jamaica. Shebeens and blues dances weren't just exclusively for people.
It started off exclusive. It started off.
They were in certain areas.
As well. I mean, you worked on the buses, right? Mm-hmm. And you were the conductor and the driver's white. And then you can't help but being together all day long, right? And you talk about what you do for recreation, and then you say to the driver, look, we're having a party over so. And he comes around and thinks, oh, that's nice, isn't it? And he tells another few of his mates of it.
Little Miss Muffet, she sat on a tuffin, eating up curds and whey. Came a big spider, sat down beside her. He frightened Miss Muffet away. Watch out! Whoa! Whoa!
We used to go down to number 9 Blenheim Crescent, where was a little cafe with a little jukebox, and you'd get some food. And I always remember Carolina was on the jukebox, and in back there was a kitchen with a chef, and you can get meat and rice. That must have been 1961. Jump up on the hill, fetch them a pail of water.
Jackie fell down and the most him come. Sister Ignatius from Alpha gave me the money to come to England. I was like our number one boy, like best boy then, you know what I mean? And she used to look after me in school very good.
He took the trumpet. And he was very helpful because I used to send him to my brother's store and so on. He used to do shopping.
It was this great cultural mix, and at the same time Buster came over from Jamaica and we had access to West Indian records.
Greatly opened areas, because the British market, I mean British record releases, was pretty limited at that time. You know, we were hearing cover versions, you had to hear the original.
Yeah, we had access to the real thing. You felt like you were at the start of something there.
By 1962, the scene was big enough to move from West London to the West End. Soon, Count Suckle's The Roaring Twenties in Carnaby Street became one of the hippest venues in town.
It was a late night dive. Maltese, prostitutes, striptease girls, the whole of the West End. Everybody, white, musician, because they come down, the Rolling Stone, they were scruffy, all of their stones. Because they used to play round the corner at a club called The Scene in Wilmill Street, downstairs. A girl named Sandra used to run it. People was like coming at 5 in the morning, 6. And that's when I met Christine Keeler, Mandy Wright Davis, and Perfumer. I mean, I didn't know he was a minister at the time, but he just come down with the girls. Well, we used to say he was a sugar daddy.
When we come to the early 20s, maybe sometimes it's 20 of us, you know, 20, 15, you know. And going home was a problem too far. We couldn't get no taxi to go home. Sometimes we have to walk, you know. Sometimes along the way you get thirsty, you know. So you drink all the milk and the orange juice inside, you know. Yeah. So you have a lot of fun, you know. You're so tired coming from the dance, you know, the snow, you know. So it was an experience in the 60s when I just come here.
You know. You know, I wonder when I come the first time in England, I remember. First time I leave Jamaica, right? When I come over London, I look through the plane. And I wonder if people live here. In your storybooks, I read so much about three little pigs and the wolf. And you see, the trouble is draw the house in the book. Then when I come in, you know, all the house stuff look like pure that house. We high, we high in the year, and you look down. It's pure that kind of house. I say, oh yes. And I look for the wolf in the book.
And wash all my troubles away. Like the lucky old sun, give me the.
In Britain was distributed on the Blue Beat label, which was how it became known. Blue Beat was the music of choice for the mods, the scooter riding youths who flocked to the concerts and made Britain a hugely important market for the music.
They saw me as a rebel and identified themselves as such. So there was some compatibility there. I think so, because you should see them when I make me sure. It's just coming at me and them as one. And then protect her right through the tour.
Like the lucky old son, give me nothing to do.
By 1964, Jamaican record entrepreneur Chris Blackwell was convinced he could get a UK hit with a ska record. He had the right singer in Millie Small, so he brought over Ernest Ranglin to London to provide the spark.
In my house, it was more on the blue spot. You was listening to a couple of blue beat tunes and stuff like that, you know. And then the biggest breakthrough was when, you know, Millie Smalls came out with My Boy Lollipop, and I think that changed everybody.
We started to get hits in England because that's where it became an international music, especially with My Boy Lollipop by Millie Small. That put us on the map. So the uptown people started to take note to make it a national sound rather than downtown sound.
Yes, this is ska, original and indigenous. These instruments are playing a monotonic grassroots rhythm.
As uptown Jamaica and the rest of the world joyously accepted ska, downtown the music and the mood were changing.
The ska was upbeat. It expressed how the spirit of the people was. And then after, people start to observe and say, oh, this independence, I'm not really independent. What's going on? The music slowed down. Let's rock it steady and see what's going on. Slow down. Poverty breeds crime. You wake up in the morning and you don't know where next meal is coming from. You know, all kind of things start going through your mind.
For if he's rough, he's against the world. He's against the world. Right
up. Don't you know you're getting slow? By 1966, downtown Kingston was a lawless place. This was the era of the so-called Rude Boys, the ruthless gangsters who terrorized the nation.
the road boys are coming and dance, man. No care you dress in a three-piece suit. Them guys that change things, them just come in our shorts and no shirt and hard turn up back way. And the girls flock them and them just do so. That's how Rap said the name did come in, you know. And the DJ have to play when he reaches, he say, cry tough with Alton Ellis and anything you can do, I can do it better. I am the toughest. And them two box of beer in the air and it mash.
This guy come to me and said, his name Busby, he was a rude boy. When I say rude, I mean rude, because he would travel with gun and he travel with knife and he would take any buckle and cut you, anything. Come to me one day and say, boy, I hear everybody has seen rude boy cry tough and oh, seven and them guys, I want you to make one of me. You just want to boost me and I want it by Friday. And so I said, okay, I'll make you a song, sir.
Strong like lion. I am rude is on fear.
Busby listen. I say play it back. I say when we reach strong like lion we are, and just take out two of the beer and throw it against the wall and crash it and say I am. Everybody getting panicked now, you know, because they're afraid of him, because they know him. What he can do from what he won't do. The whole night is the one song, it's coming like the dance stop.
Rude is on fear.
I don't know if he didn't like the song, what he would do. But anyhow, he did love it.
Boys, rudies don't fear. Rougher than rough. Tougher than tough.
But he didn't love it for long. He didn't love the song for long because he loses life the following day. And we just cut out the rude boy songs, man, and said, well, if we go and cause eruption, just leave it there.
All I need from you is a good conversation.
As things hotted up downtown, people sang, and most of them escaped into old-fashioned boy-meets-girl love songs. This was Rocksteady, Jamaica's first pop music, the era of singers who replaced the largely instrumental ska, and for many it was the most glorious phase in Jamaican music.
Never felt this way before, I know there is some way today.
It all came from the American R&B music, you know, because we're always being influenced by the Impressions, all them soul R&B groups.
Love your sister, love your brothers.
We would listen to a Dionne Warwick song and try to sing it exactly as Dionne did it. If you are a group, you would try to study the Supremes, Martha Reeves and the Vandellas. If there was a group who comes from abroad to our shores, we would want to go and see them because they have something to teach us.
It's a cultural thing for Jamaicans to sing. In the ghetto, you'll find more singers than anywhere else too, because you know it's a thing that, you know, it's a thing we used to, it's what we could use to pass the time away. It's a thing you use to soothe your spirit, your soul, you know.
Can't compare with, have been touched by an angel. This heaven and earth could be no hell. I've been touched by an angel. She's on a progressive chart, always a work for where she wants. With enough confidence, I never yet say she can't. And I love you where she have healing the broken heart from she coming on my life. I'm gonna stop, advance, rearrange my lonely life and turn it right from start. Now I'm happy with this woman and we will never part. I know she clever and she's smart. I've been touched by an angel.
Most of us, we only wanted to hear our voices on the record. To see people, to hear it on the radio is a dream come true. To see people dancing and singing to your record for the first time is another matter completely. La, 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 la.
There was no thought of any money or anything else more than honesty, sincerity, and purity. And that is what I think that music is full of. That, you know, that is why it's lasting so long.
His songs
lived. You'd have a song, man, 1 year straight. Send it for 1 year, not a little thing like some tune come and just sell for 1 month and done. Them tune they sell and never ever die. People still buying them. My biggest sales in this store is, what is? And I have everything up to date, you know, I'm up to date.
Rocksteady saw a power shift in the music industry. It was still dominated by the former sound system bosses, but Coxon and Studio One would never be quite the same force again. Many of the artists, like the Paragons, Alton Ellis, and the Melodians, promptly signed up with his old rival Duke Reed, who still ran his own sound system and realized the potential of the more easily danceable Rocksteady beat.
When the first song came out, like Alton Ellis sing a song called Girl I've Got Today. Doom, 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 boom, boom, doom, 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 doom. And when Duke Reed put on that song, I was there. He had to play the song about 12 times. And you can see this guy was very fast. He had to spin, he had to dance, he had to dance in a fast pace. So what we did was, at the time, most of them had the same bass line because the bass man didn't have enough time to emphasize on his bass line. So what we did was cut it down a little so the bass man could more move his fingers and have a line. So that's how you come to have these reggae lines. You know, you give him more time to do that. In this guy, you couldn't do that.
Reed's Trojan sound system had been notorious for the vicious fights that often accompanied his dances. Experiences which made the ex-policeman the ideal man to set up his Treasure Isle studio amongst the rude boys of downtown Kingston.
He was a no-nonsense man. He never harbored any foolishness. Police used to go and come. If you're a rude boy, you have to leave your rude boy business outside, right? Then you could have seen him. As I say, was a no-nonsense man.
And this is the studio over there, on top. What is the studio? You know, his engineer was with a man called Smitty. One of the best in Jamaica. Mr. Smitty, his engineer. Now down here was his liquor store. You'd have a lot of boxes on the roads with liquor and drinks and all that, and nobody take anything. Well, you see, Duke is respected around the area, and he's well armed. He got at least 3 guns on him. One long one, one on his hip, and one on his feet. That's Duke, the first gunman in Western Kingston.
If Duke even not in the studio, he have a box downstairs in him liquor store. And when everybody upstairs dancing, so boy, this gone, this gone. And out of nowhere, blah-boo, blah-boo. And that Duke fire shot and the whole shooter get quiet.
Then you see the big man, he run up the stairs. He say to Tom McCook and all those people, what are you playing? I don't want that. I want this, I want that. You know, everybody just shut up and listen what he said.
Then you had a on man, he's dead now, named Marquis. So listen, and Duke, so play it back, Smithy, and quiet, and Marcus put out a head like this and say, yes, yes, the boss was right. The tune need a 17 there, sir.
Rocksteady lasted 18 glorious months, but finally there was no escaping Jamaica's worsening conditions. Bass lines became heavier and the subject matter more socially concerned.
Give me money.
And we go into reggae now. And how we get reggae now? Reggae is a different changing of the drum. We have the drum playing more burro like. Oh, I don't know if you understand. Like tap ta da pa da pa pa da pa da pa pa da. And change the bass pattern.
If the music even slow, it make it sound like it fast. So that is what the reggae do to the rock steady. And that was it. Reggae, 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 reggae.
And now boys are
Reggae was everywhere. Dozens of studios sprang up and sheer volumes saturated the market. Producers needed a new outlet for the music.
A guy was working with Island at the time named Dave Bettridge, come out here and meet me, and they invite me over to England in 68, and I see what the people love. England is the gateway to really reggae music.
The English market became essential to Jamaican producers with its large and by now settled Caribbean community.
When I went to London, Bob and Dan and myself, that was when I first learned that Feel Like Jumping was also a big song in England. We were just in Jamaica not knowing what was happening.
What was happening was that by the late 60s, companies like Trojan Records had spotted the large underground following that had developed for this new reggae pop music.
White kids that were hanging out with the black kids from the same areas grew up on the music, you know, we were all hearing it. And
it was just a fashion, the youth culture of the day.
Well, that was it. We only had the youth clubs, you know what I mean? Nobody was old enough to go to nightclubs anyway.
That's it.
Trojan Records came to enjoy iconic status as the purveyors of Jamaican music in the UK. They released 2,000 singles in 7 years, initially on a fairly small scale, through specialised shops catering to Jamaicans and to white working class youths who revelled in its danceable beat and outlaw status, the skinheads.
You get kicked out of Saturday morning pictures when you're too old for it. You've got nowhere to go for yourself, so somebody said, oh, this got to Streatham Locarno. And we're talking about the 60s, sort of the skinhead period, really. And so I used to go to Streatham Locarno and listen to music, and we didn't really dance. People did dance, but me and my friends, we used to just sort of hang back and just watch, you know, because it was all the skinhead thing, you see. And because they never played that music on the radio, so in some ways, for us, it became our music.
The skinheads at the time were really into reggae. I mean, they are branded now as what you call a neo-Nazi group that don't like black people and Jews. In my time, I was being protected by the skinheads. Look, I've been to a town that was like Guildford, was a racist town in my time. And this guy said to me, hi, Mr. Black. So I said, hi, Mr. White. And he spit in my face. I said, what the heck? So the kids wanted us to beat him. But I said, no, forget it, man. I just wiped the spit off and that was it.
What was happening, it couldn't be denied that this was developing into something that was becoming more and more commercially interesting, commercially successful, as more and more people discovered the music through the clubs. And that was making for all sorts of problems for us, because we couldn't get past this door.
I think there was a perception amongst the reggae labels that the BBC dismissed reggae to a certain extent. To be fair, I think possibly, yes, I think they might have a slight case there.
Bob Marley and the Wailers failed their BBC audition because in the view of the panel, they didn't know how to play reggae. Which was, but then you get some kind of, you know, the BBC Dance Orchestra doing a strict tempo version of reggae. People would say, oh, that's how reggae should be.
If our music had an open door, like, let's say, a freeway, we could break wide in any part of the world because we are class, we have class music like anybody else. Be young, gifted or black, open your heart to what I mean.
We just did that song because we were teenagers wearing afros and, you know, trying to be too conscious black people, and we said this is a good cover song for us to do.
Trojan were determined to break reggae to the mass market and pulled out all the stops for their new releases.
When they introduced strings on the British versions, of the songs, I think it made quite a difference because they made them more into, not so much the raw sound that would probably be acceptable elsewhere, but it made it more into a pop record and then went to a much bigger market.
Reggae became part of pop mainstream. Skinheads, the BBC, school dances, suddenly everyone was playing reggae.
Sounds of soul! I am the soul, and I'm still here again.
Dave and Ansel Collins went to number one, as did Desmond Dekker. Jimmy Cliff, The Scatterlights, Prince Buster and Ken Booth all stormed the charts. And everyone loved it when Max Romeo turned out to be a new kind of rude boy.
Because there was the wonderful Max Romeo Wet Dream thing, which was just such a great pop record. Although, obviously the lyrics, you know, you can see why they had a problem with that lie down girl, let me push it up, push it up.
I tried to explain, I said, look man, I have nothing to do with sex. I'm talking about my house leaking here. Me and my lady sleeping in bed, rain falling, the roof is bloody leaking. She's getting up to plug the leak and I'm saying, lie down girl, I'll push it up. They didn't buy that.
The last couple of years of the 60s were a reggae explosion, and by 1969, Desmond Dekker was filling Wembley like visiting royalty.
That reggae pop music, I suppose, you know, we were beneficiaries of it as well, you know. The doors had been opened and people had been softened up enough to start listening, you know.
The music of downtown Kingston had not only conquered Jamaica, but made it to the heart of the old colonial masters. And there was still a great deal further to go. Everybody got to.
Part 2 next Sunday at 8 on BBC 2, and there's a new reggae website from BBCI. You can find everything from scat, a UK garage, and a guide to the Jamaican fashions and dances at bbc.co.uk/reggae. And the vibe.